Hello and welcome to Livewire's first ever series dedicated to helping investors like you get their heads around the growing universe of exchange traded products on the ASX. My name's James Marley, and throughout this series, we'll be helping you come to terms with the growing list of ETFs, active ETFs, LICs, and LITs. Today, I'm joined by Simon Shields from Monash Investors. We'll be learning why Simon likes the listed structure, get inside the strategy at Monash, and we'll be hearing about some of the core positions in their fund. Simon, great to have you here, and thanks very much for joining us today.
Great to be here, James.
Well, why don't we start from the top? It wasn't always the case, but your strategy is now listed. Why did you choose to offer your strategy as a listed product?
Well, first up, not everybody wants to invest in an unlisted trust where you've got to actually fill out an application form one way or another. They'd rather be able to buy and sell units on the share market. And until recently, LICs have been the only opportunity for people to do that, but they've got various issues at times. Could be trading at a discount, for example, might have low liquidity. We originally offered an LIC and it had those problems. So we converted to an exchange traded managed fund. So now you've got all the advantages of a unit trust, plus you've got the liquidity, plus you're trading around NTA, and plus you've got all the governance structures with a responsible entity to protect your investment.
What's the benefit of that that governance structure? Can you be a bit more specific on why you like that?
Certainly. So when you invest in an LIC, the governance structure is the same for a business. So a business that has got revenue and customers and so forth has a board of directors where the person with the largest shareholding could control the company and they really get to decide what's going on. That happens with LICs as well. You can get a controlling shareholder or a dominating shareholder. Their interests may not be the same as that of every other investor. When you're investing in a unit trust and you've got a responsible entity, they're making sure that all unit holders get looked after equally. They're not preferencing one set of rights over somebody else's or looking after somebody's interests over somebody else's. It's worked extremely well for the industry having REs, and we do have that with our exchange traded managed fund.
Okay, well, for investors that are watching this video, could you explain to them what the role of your fund is within a portfolio?
Certainly.
What's the job you're trying to do?
Okay. So we're giving them an investment in the Australian share market into opportunities and in a way they probably can't do for themselves. So what does that mean? Okay. Well, we're not going out there and giving them an index-like portfolio that they could just buy off the shelf from somebody. We're not going out there and just predominantly investing in large cap stocks where they could get some broker reports and make their own decision about whether or not they want to buy the shares. We're investing in companies where you've got to do some work to dig, to find opportunities that have large payoffs, where we can invest short as well as long, where they're predominantly small cap because they tend to be the stocks that have those opportunities at a point in time. And because we're very close to the information sources, the releases to the stock exchange, the releases by the company and the broker reports on these things, as well as our own work, we're nimble and we have a fairly high turnover in a way that they wouldn't be able to trade for themselves.
We'll come and talk about a few of the specific companies that you're interested in a little while. But when it comes to the investment strategy and your process, what are people getting access to and what do you think is unique about the way you invest?
So the most unique thing, if I can use that term, about what we do, and the thing that differentiates us most from other people, is we look for recurring business situations and recurring patterns of behaviour. So the share market has demonstrated over and over and over again, there are a number of situations where it finds it difficult to price things well in the near term. Companies that are going to have very large increases in their earnings over time, it tends to find it hard to price those companies well in the near term. It works not only on the long side, but also on the short side. There are recurring situations where 8 times out of 10, a company is going to go very badly, but the market has trouble pricing the full extent of how badly that business will end up.
Are you able to give a more specific example of how that plays out in the market?
Certainly. Well, in the case of long companies, one thing that we've seen over many, many years is when companies have store rollout strategies. So you've got a business that has a successful retail concept and that retail concept's getting replicated through time. Now, it only lasts a certain period of that company's business cycle, but we saw it in Harvey Norman in the mid-90s, we saw it in Flight Centre in the late 90s, early 2000s, and we saw it in JB Hi-Fi in the early 2000s, we're currently seeing it in Lovisa. And during these periods, you're seeing like-for-like growth anywhere from between 5 and 15%, and then on top of that, you're seeing store rollout, it's more like 10 to 20% per annum, or in some cases, at Lovisa at the moment, even higher than that at the moment. And when you have that combination and you've got a good business in terms of the margin control, in fact, probably expanding margins, then you see some very oversized earnings results, talking about 30, 40% per annum in terms of earnings growth, and then you see a much bigger outcome in terms of the share price growth. And so all those companies I mentioned, they tripled to quintupled their share prices over the course of 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, interesting. Let's get into some of the interesting trends you're seeing in your particular part of the market. We've just come off reporting season, a huge amount of information for you to digest. You mentioned earlier, you typically look outside the larger companies on the ASX. What are some of the important trends that you've picked up?
Well, it's been such a dynamic period the last few years, you know, with COVID, and then can't overplay, the huge inflection point where we went from not having inflation to having transient inflation to having persistent inflation, and what that's meant for interest rates, what that's meant for discounts for valuation in the stock market, how growth companies have been massively derated as those looking further out for those cash flows, they're worth much less than what they were when the discount rates were much lower. And so that's thrown up a great deal of opportunities. So normally we're very focused on the small cap, where that is the place where we can find these oversized returns. Well, in fact, we're seeing some larger cap companies at the moment that have fallen in share price on the back of the fact that they've got longer term earnings growth and they've been derated significantly. So we're finding more opportunities there than usual. And that means, you know, rather than having, say, less than 10% of our portfolio in large cap, we're getting more around the 30 to 35% in large cap at the moment. But we're still finding some of those small cap opportunities as well.
So is the opportunity for you in that environment to actually move into the bigger end of the market where potentially the quality of the company and the resilience of the company is a bit better?
Yes, that's right. So companies that you know, we've looked at previously and that we, you know, wanted to get an exposure to because we could see they were just fantastic companies, but we couldn't make the price right, we couldn't get the payoff that we want for our investors, we've gone into now. So for a great example of that is realestate.com. You know, you've got a derating on the stock because of the increase in inflation, interest rates and risk. You've got, at the same time, you've got a downturn in the property market and a reduction in the volume of advertising for property. So market being relatively short term has decreased that share price, and it's just an incredible franchise. The stock's got magnificent pricing power. It's such a tiny fraction of the total sale value of the house that it's charging. And of course, that sale value goes up over time. So it's not a hit at once and that's forever. It can actually keep increasing its prices over time because it'll still remain a very small fraction of that total value.
Okay. Realestate.com, one example, REA Group, I should say. What are some of the major positions and the key positions in your fund right now that people would be getting exposure to?
Well, again, some companies perhaps that they haven't heard about so much. Telix. Telix is an Australian company that provides a drug that cancer patients need. So cancer patients need to be able to identify exactly where in their body the cancer is. And it's been pretty hard to do that with existing technology, but Telix has a radioactive molecule, a drug, that attaches itself to cancer and is very easy to spot when they get scanned. And so it's providing much greater detail for doctors to identify the cancer to such an extent that they can monitor the progress of the cancer and monitor the patient's reaction to treatments over time from the cancer. Now, it's doing it for kidney cancer, it's doing it for prostate cancer, and imaging is just the first stage. The company's growing its sales at a very rapid rate at the moment, but where it will really hit pay dirt is if it can turn from just not just imaging, but into treatment. Mm. So as we've seen with companies before, like Certex with Cerspheres, if you can actually target the cancer with radiation enough at where the cancer is, you can actually treat the cancer. And once they get through the trials, if that pans out, this company will be an absolute beast.
Yeah, a really unique example. What's another example of a key position that people would get exposure to?
Another name that they might not be so aware of is a company called Johns Lyng, which is an Australian building construction repair company. Now, typically, construction companies can be very volatile and go up and down with the market and have their margins go up and down and perhaps even go bust. But this company is essentially a one-stop shop for insurance companies, and the insurance company work is very regular. There's always people making claims. Johns Lyng comes in and does its quote on a cost-plus basis. Every so often there are catastrophes, and then it's got a heap more work to do. It's preferenced by the insurance companies because it has a national footprint and it's a one-stop shop. It's also doing similar work for stratas. Now, where it's starting to really hit its straps is it's taken this model to the United States, and it's penetrating the United States very rapidly. It got a beachhead by acquiring some businesses in the United States, and the United States is very amenable to this model, and we're seeing terrific earnings growth out of Johns Lyng at the moment.
Well, Simon, we've covered a few of the long ideas that you invest in, but shorting is a unique element of what Monash does. Could you tell me a little bit about the shorting process and what's happening in the short side of the portfolio at the moment?
Sure thing, James. Well, shorting is different to going long in a stock. While we price stocks for long and we price stocks for short, we want to see that payoff. We don't look for as big a payoff out of the shorts because it's much harder to see a company go to zero than it is to see it fall by 50%. On the other hand, you know, our longs can actually double, triple, quadruple in value over time. So we don't look for as big a payoff, and we don't put anywhere near as much weight in the shorts as we do the long. Typically, we'll only put about 2-2.5% in a short, and shorts will typically be less than 10% of the portfolio overall. Now, we've seen some recurring business situations and patterns of behavior when it comes to shorts. One of the big things is when the business starts to have competitive forces go against it. So you've probably heard of Porter's Five Forces. It's the power of suppliers, it's the power of competitors, of customers, of changes in regulation. When these factors start to go against them, such as more competition coming in, and you start to see some pressure on pricing power, it sounds very theoretical, but in the real world, it actually means a great deal. And we've seen time and time again how companies collapse their earnings when these things happen. So we've had many examples over the years in the portfolio. A recent one that we've closed out not too long ago was Tyro. And Tyro fell a great deal on the back of that extra competition that came from the likes of Square, which took over Afterpay, from the likes of Apple. You can see SmartPay is coming in. This is all terminals for convenience stores and cafes and restaurants to actually have their MasterCards waived and so forth. And so the pricing's come down, loss of market share, and the share price actually has collapsed quite badly. But shorting's only one part of the portfolio, a relatively small part of the portfolio. Overall, we're mostly long investors, but again, it's just another string to our bow, another thing that we can do that really retail investors can't do for themselves.
Okay, great. Well, Simon, thanks very much for coming in today. Thanks for being part of Livewire's inaugural listed series. And for all you investors out there, the code for the Monash Absolute Active Trust is MAAT. It's listed on the ASX. Check it out. You can check it out on the Livewire website and on the Market Index website. Thanks very much for tuning in.